I think they're not retro. They're retro. Oh.
So, are you gonna do?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Are you?
We should go. We have a presence.
Thank you.
Yes.
Charles.
Did you want us to be here? You need some help here.
I am.
I mean, did you want to be all the citizens?
No.
Is that how you want to be? Okay, if there's a teacher wants to.
If I get a meeting.
Thank you.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Merry Christmas to you. Glad to have you here today. A special welcome to all of our visitors here for the Children's Christmas Service, a wonderful opportunity for them to proclaim to you the gospel, for them to tell you about all of these different illustrations of Immanuel from the Old Testament and New Testament that point to our Savior. And that's really what this season is all about, looking ahead to Jesus, celebrating his birth. And really, that's what the whole Bible is all about, pointing to Jesus as our Savior. So today we have a wonderful service planned for you where the kids get to lead it. They get to tell you all of these wonderful truths about our Immanuel, which means God with us. But I don't want to spoil too much, and I'll let them do their job there. And so we have everything printed for you in a worship folder. Everything also can follow along on the screen as well. We begin with our opening hymn, the first two stanzas of O Come, O Come, Immanuel.
Thank you.
Have you ever heard the phrase, a picture paints a thousand words? Sometimes things that are difficult to explain verbally can be better understood when depicted visually. Jesus often spoke using parables. These stories share spiritual truths using a picture of familiar things in our world. A mustard seed, a rebellious child, a wedding banquet, a lost coin. In the same way, God gives illustrations throughout Scripture that point to this central message of His holy word. He promised and sent us a Savior who is Christ the Lord. Let's gaze with wonder at some of those illustrations and renew our hearts and joy through our Savior Jesus.
In the first book of the Bible, Genesis chapter 3, we're told that God created two perfect humans called Adam and Eve. Not long after they were created, they disobeyed God's command and brought the corruption of sin into the world. When God gave the first promise of the Savior, He spoke to Satan the tempter, who was in the form of a serpent.
The promised Savior would be born from mankind. God paints a picture of this offspring of Eve crushing Satan and all his power underfoot. But the serpent is not the only picture of the problem of sin. Later in the Old Testament, there was a time when the Israelites were plagued by poisonous snakes because of their rebellious sin. God commanded Moses to make a snake of bronze and hang it on a pole before the people. God promised that all who looked at this bronze snake would be spared from death. Jesus recalls this event in the book of John chapter 3. He shows us how it points to the time when He Himself would be hung on a cross to save all people.
Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life, and for God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through Him.
After the fall, Adam and Eve's family grew and began to fill the earth.
Many years later, God appeared to their descendant Abraham and promised him that his descendants would remember as many as the stars in the sky and the sand on the seashore. God also promised that the Savior would be born from his family. But then a little while later, God asked Abraham to do the unthinkable, something that seemed to contradict God's earlier promise to Abraham. God asked Abraham to sacrifice his only son, Isaac.
Isaac did not die that day. As Abraham was about to sacrifice his son, God stopped him and provided a ram to substitute for Isaac. Each one of us could never make a sufficient sacrifice for the sins we commit. Staring eternal death in the face, we see in 1 Peter that God himself provides his son to pay the necessary sacrifice for our salvation. Jesus' perfect life provides the perfection we are unable to achieve on our own. Jesus' suffering on the cross at Calvary pays the price for our each and every sin. As God the Father rightfully raises his hand to kill each of us for our sins, he stops himself and provides his own son as our substitute to die in our place. Listen as the Apostle Peter explains.
The grandson of Abraham was Jacob, who God gave the name Israel. His descendants became the nation of Israel, and they were enslaved in Egypt for hundreds of years. God used the nation's exodus from Egypt as yet another illustration that points to our Savior, the Lamb of God. On the night before the Israelites were freed from slavery, God gave the following instructions to Moses.
Each man is to take a ram for his family. each household. Take care of them until the 14th day of the month. When all the members of the community of Israel must slaughter them at Friday. Then they are to take some of the blood and put it on the sides and tops of the door frames of the houses for the plants. On that same night, I will pass through Egypt and strike down every firstborn of all the people and animals. And I will bring judgment on all the gods of Egypt. I am the Lord. The blood will be a sign for you on the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. No destructive plague will touch you when I strike Egypt.
The blood of the slaughtered lamb protected the Israelites from the righteous wrath of God. Centuries later, John the Baptist, who was Jesus' cousin, pointed to Jesus as the perfect sacrifice whose blood would cleanse the world from their sins. Recalling the final plague in Egypt, the first blood and the blood of the lamb by which God's people were saved from death, John points to Jesus with these words.
After delivering his people from slavery in Egypt, God led the nation of Israel to the land of Canaan, which had been promised to Abraham. Here Israel would become a great nation. They would be ruled one day by King David. The prophet Isaiah tells us that King David's father, Jesse, would be the stump from which branch of the promised Savior would come forth.
The spirit of counsel and of might, the spirit of the knowledge and fear of the Lord, and he will delight in the fear of the Lord.
The prophet Micah points to the Messiah who would be born in Bethlehem, the town of King David. Please join in reading this prophecy from Micah chapter 5, verses 2 through 4 responsively.
Origins are from of old, from ancient times.
Therefore, Israel will be abandoned until the time when she and labor bears them.
And the rest of his brothers return to join the Israelites.
He will shed his
in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God.
And they will live securely, for then his greatness will reach to the ends of the earth.
Finally, the time came for the Savior to come to earth, for the Messiah to be made man, for the promised and prophesied one to be born and placed in a manger. Isaiah clearly shows us this is no ordinary baby. He came from the majesty of heaven and became like us, human, both of a virgin. He is God with us, Immanuel.
In Luke chapter 2, angels proclaim the arrival of the long-awaited Savior of the world to shepherds watching their sheep just outside of Bethlehem. The message and the messengers were a spectacular sight and sound, but the Messiah would be found seemingly helpless in a lowly place.
The Messiah,
the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find the baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared, with the angel praising God and saying,
"Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom His favor rests."
The shepherds were filled with joy and responded immediately.
The birth of the Savior would be meaningless had he not completed the work he came into the world to accomplish. Jesus himself pointed to his own death and resurrection, where he talked with Nicodemus about the sign of Jonah. The final illustration of Immanuel points to his death and victory over the grave. Jesus completed the work of salvation when he rose from the dead. He crushed the power of Satan underfoot and proclaimed victory over death, not just for himself, but for all who placed their trust in him. Paul writes to the believers in Corinth to assure them that through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, they too will live eternally with him in heaven.
Resurrection of the dead comes also through. For as in Adam all died,
From beginning to end and everyone in between, God illustrates pictures for us that point us to his son Jesus, the King of Kings, who came down from heaven, was born in a lowly manger. He became one of us. He lived perfectly in our place. He suffered the consequences of our sin. He completed the work of our salvation in his resurrection. Because of all this, we are guaranteed victory over sin and death, and promised eternal joy, where we will join the praises of the King of Kings forever.
At this time, we will collect the offering. We ask that you would also place your connection card into the offering plate, or for the very first time, you might notice that there is a digital connection card option with a QR code. If you have a smartphone, you can just point your phone at the QR code. The little pop-up will come. You click it, and then you can fill it out digitally right there as well if you'd like. Other than that, know that all of our offerings go to support our work here and around the world through our Synod at Large, the Wisconsin Evangelical Lutheran Synod. So contributing here is a contribution to our home missions, our world missions, all this other stuff that we do as well. Thank you. Thank you. Please stand for prayer. Let us pray to God our Father and worship Christ our Savior, everlasting God and Mary's Son. Heavenly Father, to whom glory is sung in the highest and peace is proclaimed to people on earth, give to your holy church the peace of sins forgiven and your continued favor and merciful goodwill. O come, let us adore him. On Christmas night, you sent the angels to preach the good news of Jesus' birth. Give to all pastors of our church courage to lead as boldly to the Christ child. Fill us with joy that we may each make known abroad the glad tidings concerning this child, that more may be given faith to confess him as Lord. O come, let us adore him.
Christ the Lord.
Bless our country, all its citizens, and all who are in authority over us. Cause your glory to dwell among us, and let mercy, truth, and justice prevail everywhere, that throughout our land people may come to know the Prince of Peace. O come, let us adore him. Merciful God, we thank you for the joys of family and friends this season, together with the abundance of your blessings. Open our hearts and homes to the lonely and destitute, that we may be your instruments of love and charity. O come, let us adore him. Remember, we pray, the homeless, hungry, and oppressed, and give them hope. Protect the lonely and homebound of our parish. Grant peace and healing to the sick and suffering and those in the hospital. Guide the journey of those who travel. Comfort those who mourn. Create a new and contrite heart and the erring and faith in those who have not heard the good news. O come, let us adore him.
Praise the Lord.
Lord God, make a manger in the hearts of all who come to the altar, that they may treasure up and ponder the marvelous gifts of salvation you give there through the very body and blood of the Lord Jesus. O come, let us adore him.
Praise the Lord.
In the birth of your Son, O God, who have clothed us with eternal life, we remember with thanksgiving all those who have died in the faith. Unite our voices with theirs, that we may join the heavenly song of angels. O come, let us adore him.
Praise the Lord.
For all these things and whatever else you want, you would have us ask, we implore you to hear us, gracious Father, through Jesus Christ our Savior, whom together with the Holy Spirit we praise, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
May he who by his incarnation gathered things earthly and heavenly into one, fill us with such joy that comes with the knowledge of the forgiveness of sins and the hope of eternal life. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. The congregation may be seated, and we continue with our closing hymn. Thank you. Welcome once again, and Merry Christmas to you. Glad to have you with us. A special welcome to all of our visitors with us today. We hope you enjoyed the children teaching us a little bit about our Immanuel, about our Savior who came into this world and forgave our sins and whose birth we celebrate in just a week from now. A few announcements I want to highlight. First of all, your screen right here is correct. The one in the bulletin is wrong. We had the wrong days on there. This one's right. The other one's wrong. The other one looked like it was wrong there. But we do have our North Liberty Christmas worship on Thursday, December 22nd at 6 p.m. in North Liberty. That same service will be here in Cedar Rapids at for our Christmas Eve worship on Saturday, December 24th at 7 p.m. And then on Sunday, a week from now, our Christmas Day worship will be at 9 a.m. And you're all invited to come back to join us for that service. A few other announcements. We have our fellowship right after this. We have all the shepherd kids together, so they will enjoy having shepherd kids together from both campuses, and we'll also have our Bible study, which starts at 10:30. On Tuesday, we have our church council, and the Ladies Guild is not going to be meeting. That's December 20th. And want to say a very big thank you to all of those who contributed to the seminarian gift, and also to our seminarian, who is on his vicar year, Hugo. What a wonderful thing that we can give them a little bit extra encouragement with our words and our gift this time of year to support them in their current ministry and their future ministry as well. The rest of the announcements I'll let you read for yourself, but please do you are invited to join us downstairs for some fellowship before our Bible study, and we would love to have you there as well. God bless your week, and again, you take care.